Well, good morning and thank you very much for joining us. I am Yori Folan. Okay, this morning let's look into the case of former Governor Bala James Ingilari of Adamawa. He's been jailed 5 years for, you know, corruption there. So arguably, the fight against corruption, the war against corruption, has moved up one notch. This is, any way you look at it, this is a significant conviction. In fact, it goes along the lines of what most commentators have said we don't see any of. Since we've started this whole campaign against corruption, we've not seen conclusions of the case. No doubt this will go some way in mitigating the angst, suspicion. So let's look at this. The whole matter of impunity, is this the beginning of it being a way out? Because this is a very, very high profile conviction. My guest this morning, Barrister Uche Onu, public affairs analyst. Thank you very much.
I'm happy to be here.
And our friend Olaniwaju Suraj, chairman, Civil Society Network Against Corruption. Thank you for coming on, Larry.
Always a pleasure.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure.
My pleasure to have you. First of all, all over the world, nobody's above the law.
That's right.
It goes right up to presidents.
That's right.
But in our clime, that still holds, that nobody is above the law. But when it comes to the practice, we've seen cases that confuse what you lawyers refer to as the unlearned among us. That is because you don't know. Do you see this as significant in the fight against corruption? Do you think a tide is turning?
Well, I think for those of us that have been at the forefront in advocating for the retention of the immunity clause in the Constitution, we have been vindicated by this latest development. Don't forget, there have been divided opinion as to whether some have said that it should be expunged from our Constitution to enable us hold immediately anybody who is still serving as a governor, deputy governor, president or vice president accountable for any criminal malfeasance the person must have committed while in office. But we have said that we should be left. Rather, let us see how we could strengthen institutions of government that will hold them accountable when once they come out from office. Mm. And this is exactly the scenario that have played out. If we go about removing them or expunging from the Constitution, it will bring about all manner of distraction. Maybe by now, in the course of being in office, there will be one kind of being toyed up and down, tossed from this court to the other. But we have said, let it be retained there in the Constitution, but strengthen our institution so that when once the person hands over and come down, he will face squarely the consequence of his both criminal and civil actions while in office. Mm. I think this thing that I played out is a very welcome development. It has sent a very good and positive signal, even to those who are still in office, to know that one day, when once you leave that office and then that cloak of immunity is removed from you, that one day you'll be answerable to the law. So I give it's a very kudos to the ongoing war against corruption.
Indeed, and just in case anybody didn't know about it, wasn't in the country yesterday or anything like that, the case really goes to 167.8 million naira fraud that involves the governor. Well, I don't think we use the word allegedly anymore since the matter has gone to court. The governor was the only person who knew. He handed the contract for the purchase of cars to somebody that he knew and nobody else knew. Oh, by the way, for the former secretary of the government and commissioner for finance, they were discharged in this whole matter. So only ex-governor Ingilari faces the situation.
Actually, I have actually received this with mixed, reaction. In one breath, celebrating; in another breath, I'm being cautioned to also be sure that this is actually not a mirage and at the same time not a flash in the pan, to the extent that we would have celebrated so much that, the judiciary is finally up and doing, let me say the judicial system, both with the lawyers and the judges, to the extent that this case could be prosecuted within this short period of time, whereas you still have those who have similar matters in court pending for over 14 years, and all you would see, Joshua Darie and the rest of them, they've gone to Supreme Court and then back into the trial court on similar matters or even of higher magnitude than this one. But with this is actually a very great reason for us to celebrate. And it's also important to recognize the fact that if the anti-corruption agency, the judges and the lawyers, both the prosecutors and the defense counsel, are committed to the social reengineering of the system, we can actually have corruption rolled back from the country. But as long as you still have that political maneuvering and legal gymnastic that you always experience in court, taking into technicalities to pull suspects out of the eyes of the law, then it's going to be extremely difficult.
Uche, that, on that point, this all went relatively fast.
Yes, yes.
What do you attribute that to? He just made the point, everybody knows about it. Some cases spend ages, 10 years in the system.
Yeah, it's purely a matter of discretion for the counsel that is handling that matter. From what we have heard from the history of this case, it is obvious that the lawyer that defended the ex-governor probably did not make frivolous applications, but rather choose to handle the case directly and say, let me be given an accelerated hearing. So I think it has been a habit of most, you know, senior lawyers, whom some of these governors engage, to apply it as a delay tactic. So probably what must happen in this case, and the system condones
it. It stands for
this. But I think it is the area where we are calling on the new CJN to make sure there is a rule, he fast track the rules of court that will make it impossible for people who have such mindset to get scot-free from that. So from what we could see from that case, it just means that the matter commenced immediately without frivolous application, going to a lower appellate court to look for somebody, rather chose the defense counsel to proceed on with the matter at once. And once you are serious with the case, I'm telling you, not take up to a year in any EFCC matter that I know. It will not, unless this subterranean means have been introduced to subvert the course of justice.
Larry, you spoke about the need that analysts, commentators have always put out there to strengthen our institutions more than anything else, and then see the whole society. Now, you think something of that is happening in the case of EFCC as one of those institutions?
Oh yes, actually, interestingly, which is why I also expressed that my major serious concern. I will give you a typical example. The former MD of Bank PHB, Atuche, is matter that has dragged over the years, also involving the EFCC, came up before the Supreme Court precisely on the 2nd of this month, 2017. And I can tell you, the Supreme Court actually adjourned that matter from the 2nd of March to 1st of March 2018. That is a whole year adjournment. This is a matter that still needs to go back to the trial. In fact, as at the trial court, the prosecution has closed his case. The defense had called, I think, about 3 or 4 witnesses. And then the Supreme Court stalled that process by adjourning even its own, hearing till 1st of March 2018. So it means that we are not yet at Uhuru. And there's a need for us to also analyze some of these cases, case by case, and be able to point out where did we. It might be, like he said, just that lawyer, the defense lawyer, who had said, I'm not going to go into these macabre dams like you witnessed with the Senate president, the current Senate president at the Code of Conduct Tribunal, where he had to go to Supreme Court once, came back, and was going on that expedition again until they said, look, you just go and face this substance of this matter. And also the judge was also as upright as possible, took his time out to deal with the merits of the case without pandering to any form of unnecessary frivolous application. And many times it's not usually on the side of the defense. It could also be on the side of the prosecution.
Yes, yes.
So then it means that we need to identify the judge and give credit where it's appropriate. We also identify the lawyer, give credit as it is appropriate for this.
Yes.
And then other cases, put the judiciary under the spotlight.
We'll just go on a commercial break now. Stay with us, please. Welcome back, Court Jill's former governor in Gilari. And interestingly, to most people who are not close to the law, there's this other matter about he's going to be allowed to serve the term, his prison term, in a jail of his choice. Well, just talk about that briefly. It's not very usual that you are given an option.
You see, that sentence that the court passed, upon which he was jailed 5 years, was predicated on his violation of a public procurement act, not the criminal code, not the penal code. So each law has a prescribed way of doing its own. Okay. I think on that section, from what I was doing, I've not gone through it properly. From what I gathered in Sun this morning, page 13, they said that it was predicated based on a provision of that public procurement act that makes expressly for that provision. And when what that is the provision, there is nothing anybody can do. So if it is what that public procurement act provide for, so the court did all within the ambit of the law.
So we have the situation where a convict, you know, leaving court,
depending on what,
has to make up his
depending
mind
on that which law, depending on that which law. I said not under criminal. This kind of court, it could be akin to the act which Olabode judge was, not under criminal code, under for breaching, and that could be classified as a higher level of crime. Not an ordinary person will commit that crime.
That's
so, which means the law still makes provision for the rich people.
That is the thing.
So, poor man cannot be charged, or somebody who is not under that public procurement act.
And exactly.
Yeah, so
even though at the end of the day, conviction is conviction. But in the case of a poor man who stole a goat, no judges or magistrate is going to ask him, so my friend, where do you prefer? I'm going to send you, is it Abuja you want or your state? Nobody asked him.
Capitalism, its ramifications in society.
Exactly. It's one of those crimes that an old man cannot really commit. And then even as we're at it, there are some... they look like privileges, but I'm sure that was not the intention. Now, lessons to be learned from this. Hopefully, everybody concerned at those high levels are learning that it's not business as usual. Because maybe there are those who might say that, well, in Gilari, you know, his matter came to how it came because of the friends he doesn't have or because of the friends he does have, because of the connections he has or because of, you know that kind of a thing, because we've never seen this kind of a thing before.
Yeah.
So there will be those speculations. Friends or anything don't come into the law.
Yeah.
You know. Friends or something don't come into the law, but this is home, and we know how we do. Mr. Sodiq in Jigawa wants to come on this conversation, and we're happy. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Okuri.
Thank you for coming in.
Good morning to you two gentlemen in the studio.
Good morning. Thank you.
So I think it's what have the judgment we got that was delivered yesterday by the court. I think it's a great milestone to our judiciary.
Was it surprising to you? Was it surprising that such a big man, you know, dealt with, well, you know, had the law, you know, was confronted by the law, and indeed the law, you know, prevailed?
That's why I said it's a great milestone. So I think what I would suggest is, if our institution can be strengthening, or the constitution amended per se, that once an ex-governor is convicted, he can't appeal, he must go and serve the jail term. And secondly, the judge that handled the case should be given a further commendation by the president, so that it will encourage the fellow judges in handling corrupt issues. So I think it's going to be a great achievement
indeed
for institutions.
Thank you very much for calling in, Sadiq. Indeed, there are a lot of people who will read this well. It looks like we're coming back to normalcy. You know, maybe it's a bit hyperbolic when we're angry and we talk about these matters and we talk about in Nigeria crime pays. Well, hello, it's like take it easy. You know, things might have happened in the past, but things are changing. No matter how gradually, things are changing. That's the way a lot of people will want to read this. Would that be reading too much into it?
No, actually, things are changing, and you need to also get to Abuja, for instance, and you see how lifestyle of people are actually changing in terms of, you know, the former penchant for, logs, roofings and commodities.
Conspicuous consumption.
Exactly. And also the abuse and reckless display of wealth is actually things that you can critically say are really not actually like before. Mm. And then also when you go around to even many of those houses that are completely difficult for people to even come and lay ownership and claim to, and even defend.
I hear that most of them have been abandoned.
Itself. Oh, seriously?
Nobody wants to claim ownership for this.
The irony of it is nobody claims ownership. Nobody wants to buy.
And nobody wants to
careful,
buy.
You are careful of what you're buying because you
so. Reverend Dominic, good morning, sir.
Good morning, Yori. How are you today?
Very well, thank you.
Good morning to your guest.
Good morning.
Thank
you. The only person who can give credit in this judgment is the victim or if the man who is the criminal now. We can't give respect to it. The Ngaleri person, we give him credit. And that credit is this way. The man did not have money. Do you know how much Sariki pay a senior advocate to take a matter from magistrate court to police court to a law court before it goes to high court? Do you know how much they pay a senior advocate? The man did not steal big. People who stole big can be led judgment. Let me tell you the governor of part of my state. Ojikalu, ex-governor, is a multi-billionaire. Since 2007, he has been starting trial. And every time they bring a witness, they will find a way to stop the witness. This is almost 10 years now, because the man has money. This man went to prison because he didn't have enough money. And that was the pain in our nation. People stay here and stole the one of the lawyer and stole one of the prison services, and then you stole the one you give to the judge. This man did not have much time in government to steal up dry so he can delay the justice. Elijah has gone to court and convinced. He paid for his pass. But let's give credit to the judge. Who did give option of a fine? He could have found a way to pay it. Good job to the judge. He didn't give you option to pay fine.
No, sir.
There was no option of a fine. Hello? Okay, I've lost Reverend Dominic temporarily. Mm-hmm. But Reverend Dominic, I think a slight point of correction, no option of fine, right?
Yes, yes, no option of
fine. And because that would have been easy to sort out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
In fact, funny, you know, in a bizarre sort of way, there are people who are commenting that you see now, this man, 168 million naira only. That's how bad things have become. Only 168 million naira.
Would you blame them when you can hear an ordinary minister has more than $53 million
That
is just even in an account. And several other properties worth billions of naira.
But he was in office for such a short time, and you would have thought that because he was in office for such a short time, even if anybody had a propensity, the mere fact of not being there would have prevented him from doing it. But still, the Oga managed within that short time to wreak as much havoc. Let me bring in Mr. George, who's waiting to join the conversation. Good morning, Mr. George.
Uncle Yori, good morning.
Good morning, sir.
And good morning to the panelists.
Good morning.
Thank you.
Uncle Yori, I do not agree with that argument that it is because the ex-governor did not have enough money to argue his case. That's why he lost. No, that's not the truth. But what I really want to say, Uncle Yori, is that I have just been vindicated on my position when I called to tell you that I am not in support of this CGN that is being sworn in today. That if not for ethnic emotions, merit should have been the yardstick for consideration, not ethnicity. And I've just been vindicated now. What do I mean? The Administration of Criminal Justice Act says that you should not adjourn a case for more than 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And cases should be tried consecutively. Mm-hmm. The judge in Adamawa State has just demonstrated that he is following that law. But in the Supreme Court, where the CGN is, they have just postponed or adjourned the case for 1 year against that law. If you were the one appointing CGN, which one will you pick out of these two to become the CGN of Nigeria? If you don't want to look at where you came from, the ethnicity and all the other external considerations that people put forward, which one will you pick, Uncle Yori? I'm asking a question.
Mm-hmm.
So you can see that we need merit in this country.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We need the likes of justice. So yeah, well, people like Ulisa Akpakuba and the Femi Falana. If you make those people chief justice of Nigeria, this country will change. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. George. I take your point. Over to Uche.
I think there's an element of truth in what he has said, because this administration of criminal justice that was enacted in 2015, it has a lot of fine provisions that ought to, you know, remove some of these bottlenecks in the administration of justice, like what he has said on the issue of adjournment. Then, but unfortunately, and it's unfortunate to say here that what we see in Lagos courts is always very burdensome. Because if you could go to, if you go up a matter maybe in a city like Abeokuta here or neighboring state, you see that that is where they follow this thing strictly. I don't know why Lagos zone and Abuja, we are two major cities, they always find it difficult. That's why you could see a list of about 40 cases before one judge in a day. And when they come, they will not do justice to any of the cases. But if you go to all the city like Abeokuta, you will see a judge who handle one your case for more than 3 hours.
Yes. I wonder if it's, I don't know very much about the administration of justice, but could it be that people, places like Lagos, like Abuja, like Port Harcourt, those real centers, quite frankly, a lot of people are doing more wrong in those centers simply because there are a lot more people. So statistically, it looks like there are
maybe
many more people.
Maybe because of the cosmopolitan nature. I don't know, but you tend to get quicker justice in a smaller state, you know, and towns. Unlike these cities we didn't mention, these are areas we really need to look into.
Actually, it's actually a fail of a fail of government and a fail of administration. So there wouldn't be any excuse to say because of the cosmopolitan nature of Lagos or Abuja, because a government that is responsible must factor all these into consideration. Indeed. So then it will require of you provide more courts, provide more judges, and ensure the monitoring of the process. Many of the times, you will see that these judges are usually even either non-sitting or they are not even available.
Great, thank you. So we'll go on a break now, but no problem. We'll be right back and we'll include your calls as we have been doing. Ex-Adamawa Governor Ngilari jailed 5 years for awarding a contract to unlawfully awarding a contract to a contractor known to only him. And Mr. Yakub is on the line. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Kikari.
Thank you very much for calling.
And good morning to the two white men in the studio.
Thank you.
Good morning. Kikari, you see, this is a welcome development in our judicial system. But having said that, Kikari, you see, the man in question, the governor, the former governor of Adamawa State, he spent a very small time of time in office, a very short period of time in office, and then he takes some amount of that. What about if he spent 8 years? How much do you think that the man would take? That is where if the man has opportunity to stay in that office for that 8 years, he should have more money in his pocket to fight that war. And then you can believe me that it will take almost another 10 years, like all you so Kalu of this world and other people. Because you don't have much to give. It is a little. So you don't have that resources. So make sure that they postpone the judge. So Shibyori, another thing is this. Dominic said that there was option of fine. He means to say there was option of which prison he should to leave. Because they'll give him option of which prison he choose to go. What about him? I don't know why the judge gave him that opportunity. Some man does not give him that kind of opportunity. There should not be. They should allow him to go a prison where there's no roof. Let him stay under the prison that there was no roof. If there's a storm, if there's a rain, we'll meet him there. Mm-hmm. And God bless you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Yakub, for calling in. That matter has been touched upon by our in-house lawyer.
But I think it's also important to also, while we look at the negative side of the short period of stay in office, also the positive side. The positive side is to the extent that even though he stole, but he didn't have the opportunity to wet different hands. Who would have protected him in the course of the prosecution?
So aside from the fact that he didn't steal enough to probably settle the lawyers, he also didn't involve so many people who would have prevented the successful prosecution of the matter.
And that is a very worrisome thought.
Precisely. Like, exactly. So we must understand.
Yakub brought it up. But it's worrisome because Yakub is saying in there, and Larry seems to have given a nod to that line of thinking, that administration and delivery of justice in this country is all about money.
Yeah.
It's not about your right. It's not about justice. It's about the law. The law is one thing. Justice is not the same as the law. And the point is being made now that, you see, if he had more money, it might have gone differently. That should be worrisome to lawyers. It's a speculation, by the way.
Yes.
It's a speculation. But can you understand it?
Well, one thing I want the callers to understand, that the thing is gradually ebbing away. It's no longer business as usual. I, for instance, am a practicing lawyer. I know what is obtainable now in the system. Most times, if
different
you have
from
cases,
before?
Yes, different from before. But right now, presently, there might be some high-profile cases that you have. If you want to make a call across to somebody, maybe a top-ranking police officer, either enforcement, they will tell you, please, lawyer, you go there and handle it by yourself. It's not because everybody is afraid now. So what they would simply advise is to go and sort it out, unlike before, where anybody could just use a phone call and ask the other person on the other end to, you know, do this or don't do this.
Now everybody's
everybody's being careful. Must give it to this system presently now. It is not business as usual.
The judicial, the bench is being careful.
Yes.
The lawyers are being careful.
Yes.
Maybe police are being careful as well. Everybody
is
being very, very careful. Mr. Chidi in Kaduna, good morning, sir.
Good morning, Uncle Yori.
Good morning, sir. You're on air now.
Hello, Uncle Yori.
I can hear you, sir. You're on air right now. Go ahead, please. Oh dear. I can hear you. Go ahead.
Uncle, comment about the unfortunate incarceration of former Governor Ngilari.
Unfortunate?
It is really unfortunate.
Explain.
No, we can network us in a minute.
No, the network is fine. There's a delay.
I should try to say at this point in time that if there is a way for him to make an appeal so that sorry, the line is breaking. It is
Chidi, you're out. I don't know, there must be. Actually, you were as clear as a bell here, but there is a satellite delay, and that's why I sort of held my peace so that we wouldn't be clashing. When the satellite delay, because you were calling us from Kaduna, when it happens like that, there might be a 2-3 second delay, and that sounds like an eternity. So see if you can get us again, and if you do, don't bother about me, just go right on. If there can be a way for, if he can find a way to appeal, no, there's not finding a way. It's his right, right?
It is his right.
It's his right. It's his right, and I think I've read something to that effect that they're about to. But I would have loved to hear from Chidi what he meant by unfortunate conviction. Mazi Okorafo, over in Arochukwu, good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, our guest in this. My name is Comrade Mazi Patrick Okoro Krafo, Arochukwu Blue Village. Mr. Yoda, I want to find out from our guests in the studio. Now that the judgment has been made, thank God that things are moving like one of our guest speakers said that business is no longer as usual, business is not unusual. Now I want to find out the man in question, the judge, do other judges in Nigeria, do they observe what happened here today? Why am I asking this question? Like one of the guests said here in the studio, there are cases that have spent over 6 days, 4 years in Nigerian court. Can the judges presently feel action so that all those cases in Nigerian court, at least before the end of this month, all of them will be cleared? So that we know exactly our position, because the judiciary, like, there's nothing wrong about you collected money, you did business, and at the end of the day, it's not left for Nigeria. When you are coming to vote, you now look at yourself and say that these people I'm going to vote, is it people of pure integrity before I vote? Because what happened yesterday is good. It's a welcome development in Nigeria. That will show that with the new coming CJ now, that means there is hope for Nigeria judiciary. So that other judges, so Nigeria judges will now sit up. Mm. What do I mean by sit up? And even the lawyers themselves. If a case will not work, you tell your client, point blank, look, what you are fighting for will not work. So that save your money. Not collect the money and say that we are pushing. You carry a case, you divide the case into five.
Mazi, thank you very much for calling. Uchi, I'm coming to you again because what he said, it was like the wish of the ordinary guy, the ordinary Joe, that why can't everybody be like that judge? And if everybody, when I say everybody, I'm talking about the bench in Nigeria, if they decided to toe that line, you know, theoretically, in one quarter, we could get rid of most of these courts, but they don't do that, and there probably are very, very good reasons, right? Why?
Like I said before, it depends on the counsel that is defending the accused person. Probably the counsel that defended Gilari did not just deem the fit to go on straight away with the case without applying a delay tactics of going on appeal, challenging this interlocutory application.
So from the point of view of the defendant, his defense might have been termed incompetent. From the point of view of the defendant.
No, he did what was not very competent. He was very professional.
From the point of view of the people.
He was very professional about it. That's the way it's supposed to go. When once you have a case,
but wasn't the lawyer supposed to do his best to keep him out of jail?
Well, some employ unprofessional means of doing that, which I don't support.
Okay.
So what I'm really saying, there are a lot of factors that do the. But for the judges, I want Nigerians to understand that there is a code of conduct that guides all judges, has been given to them by NJC, that there are certain period of time you are supposed to deliver judgment, and the case is not supposed to lack all those things. They are there in place. But the only thing is that most times...
So this whole judicial reform that we're talking about, it's part of it.
As I'm talking to you now.
No, I think the judicial reform is not going to happen with just judges changing or lawyers changing. There must be vigilance on the
vigilance
part of the people.
Vigilance, oversight.
Okay, let me come back so you can proceed. You can elongate on that point. Kinapa in Kaduna, good morning, sir.
Hello, good morning, sir.
Thank you for calling in.
Yeah, I'm calling from Kaduna.
We're happy to have you.
Yeah, what happened? The conviction of Governor Angleari is a welcome development. Mm-hmm. And this has given hope to the common Nigerian that with this present judges, this kind of conviction that happened, we can say that the elite are also not, they will not freely steal Nigerian money and go. Because a common man like me here now will get rest of mind that if a person of that high caliber can be convicted, then what much more of this thing? And this has opened the door for this administration. It has showed their sincerity in fighting this corruption. And I hope that Nigerians should come together collectively to ensure that we get out of this mess, because nobody should be spared. My greatest this thing now is for us to shun religious and ethnic sentiment. If we can overcome this one, whosoever that is being convicted, Nigeria should not look at him from where he comes from or from what religion or whatsoever. If we do this, I'm telling you, Mr. Presenter, Nigeria will get get over this issue. And I want to commend your guests. They have spoken fine, and they've spoken the mind of Nigeria. Thank you. I remain IA Kinapa from Kaduna. Thank you so much, and stay blessed.
Thank you very much for writing us that lovely letter. Really appreciate your calling in. The whole system of, and that is what it has become, a system of impunity in Nigeria. People know, and it's very worrying, people know that nothing is going to happen because of the caliber of the person that might be in the subject of the matter. But now this is sort of confronting that.
You see, I would like us to go back to the early stage in this country where, you know, judicial officers like judges, they were completely isolated from the society.
Mm-hmm.
If you cast your mind back when we were growing up, you hardly see a judge, you know, or even where he's a resident of a judge, you hardly see them. But today what we see, because of the infiltration of the political class, you now see judges attending, you know, ceremonies hopefully that are not supposed to be. So I would like us to go back to that era where, you know, the traditional way, we are judges, we are being seen as the demigods.
Well,
you could hardly see judges on the way. And when you see them,
they weren't as social as
these are part of the, It's high time we begin to, not whenever you see...
But the world is changing. It's dynamic.
Even the U.S., exactly. Country where we borrowed some of the... You hardly see judges coming up.
You're not supposed to see judges anyhow.
Yes, anyhow. Mingling with politicians.
I want Larry's perspective, but let me quickly include Mr. James, who has called in from Maryland. And I'll come back to... I hope you still remember the point you were going to... good morning, Mr. James in Maryland.
Good morning, Uncle Yari.
Thank you for calling in, sir.
How are you?
Very well, thank you.
Good morning. A good one this morning.
I like that.
Yes. Mr. Barrister Uche is my neighbor, my biggest brother in Maryland. Good morning.
Good morning. And, thank you.
Good morning to the other guest.
Thank you.
You see, there's a step forward. We are moving somewhere.
Okay.
And those who believe that Nigeria will not get out of this mess, they are just playing games. And the time of the games are over. Believe it or you leave it. Like I do calls most times, I tell look, until we begin to take those steps like this, where even though your brother, your own blood brother, when you know that he's killing you, because no one of us will sit down, and when somebody is pointing a weapon of destruction towards you, and you fold your hands. So here we are now. I just want to say one thing on this program. The sure. judge who actually made this judgment, can we give him more cases? And like those cases that we'll be having like 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, because you know there was a time when we had judges issues. Yeah, I said something. I said, have we gone back to see those judges? Well, we have found one thing. And you know, there are people just because they could not afford to buy that rights, and you just give them unnecessary judgment, and you said, this one is executing somebody. And this is something that cannot be replaced. 15 innocent people, because somebody is there that can buy the case over, have we called those judges back and said, okay, because most of these cases are being swept under the carpet.
Okay. Thank you very much for calling in, Mr. James. I've got to take a break now because, you know, I just must go for a break. Thank you very much for calling in. Stay with us, please. Now it's the turn of Samuel in Abuja to join the conversation. Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, sorry. Concerning the issue of this man in Adamawa, I think there's this political undertone. Then secondly, good morning. Yeah, sorry. I think I came early concerning your...
Samuel, go ahead. Did you say you think there's a political undertone to this conviction?
Yeah, sure. Because most of the issues we have in Nigeria so far have to do with our judiciary. And let me give you an instance. I think like 2 weeks ago, I was with my lawyer and we were discussing an issue. And...
There was something wrong with that, and I don't know why it's happening like this. Now this gentleman has said there was something political about it, and then the telephone line, conspires against it. The other guy said it was an unfortunate conviction. The telephone line conspired against our hearing what he meant. But it'll be interesting to hear. In spite of what the gentlemen are saying, many more would probably think that, look, this is about business unusual. It's not business as usual.
Business.
But when I interrupted you about 2-3 conversations ago, telephone conversations ago, you're going to talk about the part of the citizenry and vigilance. How did you mean? How can that do anything?
No, that actually is the only way you can have the changes, because I've repeated that here, especially the legal profession is actually a cult. Profession that the high and mighty who determines what happens in the profession are also heavily enmeshed in the rot that we're complaining about, and there's always a meeting point between
lawyers don't like what you're saying very much.
No, they don't need to like it. I'm not saying that which is going to be planned
because let referring me give to you the profession as a cult.
No, let me tell you. Yeah, I said it. Many of them would.
No, okay. Some of them would argue. Okay. Quote, those who are sincerely concerned mm-hmm. about what happens in the profession would also admit that to you.
Okay.
As we speak currently, one of the members of the Legal Practitioners Disciplinary Committee, that is the committee of the MBA responsible for sanctioning lawyers found wanting in the in professional misconduct, is also standing trial as of today for professional misconduct, for bribing of judges, and is still a member of that Legal Practitioner Disciplinary Committee. The same thing happened with the NJC.
Blameless until proven otherwise.
No. That is part of the rule. Once you are also, because it's part of the civil service rule, once you are charged with offenses, you are meant to be interdicted. So for the period that you're standing that trial, is meant to have actually stepped down from that. So how do you even have the moral standing to sanction another lawyer for any of them when you yourself are under trial for criminal offenses?
Meanwhile, Mr. Marvelous in Ikosiketu is waiting. Good morning, sir.
Hello, good morning, Mr. Yori.
Thank you for calling.
Good morning to your guest in this
Good morning.
To me, I feel the case of this governor, it is a good development that he has been arrested and brought to trial. But what about the rest of the governors that are flaunting? Like, I know even there are some present governors. What I want is for them to make the institution strong, that you cannot even steal. It's not about them arresting or recovering money. Make the institution strong. Make the ESCC strong. Make the, that you cannot steal a dime. Because even the current governor of Kogi said it. He said, even if I steal, I go and report me to Donald Trump. Nothing will happen. He even said that we pay $500,000 for anybody that carries rumor around, that you can report anybody that carries rumor about him, he will pay you $500,000. To me, this is very wrong. Those kind of governors now, how will you bring them to prison? Because when they come outside, they will be super rich and they can hire the best of the best lawyers. So to me, they should look out to make the institution strong, that any man or any governor will not be above the law and even attempt to steal. Like even China, if you can pass a law against corruption, like 51, then you will be hanged or shot. Then I will know that, yes, this country is moving forward. Thank you very much.
Indeed, thank you, Mr. Marvelous, for calling in. And when you look at it, in office, when you're a governor, if you're so minded, I imagine there are so many defenses that you could plead. But the main plank that the vehicles were, I mean, the judge said that since the vehicles were not, you know, security vehicles, you can't hide under the provisions of emergency. And so the judge declared that the defense lacks legal protection and merit. Now, that is a statement that is unambiguous. Yes. It's clear. It's clean. We probably want the bench to be speaking, you know, as forthrightly on these matters. But you don't always get that. You don't always get that. I'm thinking. Okay. Everybody wants to comment on this whole matter. Mr. Musa in Minna. Good morning, sir.
Hello. Good morning.
Thank you for calling in. Go ahead, please.
This is all about my. I wanted to contribute about the contradiction, the execution of the former governor of Adamawa State, Balajan.
Which contradiction? Did you say contradiction?
Hello?
Okay. You may, what contradiction?
No. Hello?
Hello, sir.
For sentences for 5 years imprisonment.
Okay.
For the corruption allegation against the former governor of Adamawa State, Balajan Sinclari.
Okay.
It is a very welcome idea.
Oh, okay.
It is a very welcome idea from the current administration. But honestly speaking, that is selective. The fighting of the anti-corruption crime in Nigeria is selective.
Okay.
For the present administration, because there is political sentiment. There are a lot of former governors. Because they are not. Hello?
I couldn't hear. We can hear you. We can hear you.
There are a lot of ex-governors, and the common tend to prosecute them.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's why we say that there is political sentiment in the anti-corruption.
I hear you.
Are you with me?
Yes. So, thank you very much for calling in. I appreciate your call. I understand exactly what you're saying. Whereas you said you identify with this event, but there still are so many in the system that the matter never reached. But people might say that the longest journey, the first step, and one might look at this as a first step, but what do you gentlemen think about about that, because I was a bit in it. I didn't hear when it's, I thought I heard the word contradiction. I was trying to get, but maybe this is what he means in a sort of a way that look
selective.
And then he thought selective. So people come up with this. Maybe this is part of our memory of how it used to be, even though it has been said it's not like that anymore. It won't be like that anymore. But the memory is so strong.
Is the fact that either it is selective or it is open. The man who has been convicted did not even come to say, I've been persecuted. And either you are selecting 1 out of 10 or 10 out of 100, it is a step that we must move.
It is a
so
step
let
in the
us
right
even
direction.
Start selecting from the ones that we can bring down.
Rather
bring
than not
down
do anything.
Anything, or you know, even just go in and losing it all.
Let me bring in our last caller of the day. That's Mr. Godwin calling in from Ikeja. Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Ayobi.
Yeah.
And good morning to the two gentlemen there.
Good morning, thank you.
You see, my contribution this morning is this. If what just happened now, if we can continue with that, then we agree that, yes, we have really changed that now, meaning that we are going somewhere. But if this is just one out of a million, then it is not thin yet. Because over time, this nation has gone through very bad situation because of people like this, because what they call immunity, that they arrogate to themselves. Well, whether it is from the constitution or not, as far as I'm concerned, you cannot continue to commit crime in the name of anything. You commit a crime, you say, because you are this person, this position or the other, and then you can do whatever you want, and you say immunity is there. Let Nigeria come to this part.
Thank you very much for calling in. Really appreciate your call. Well, it's one, because it certainly isn't two. But the important thing is, it's now shown that it can be done.
Yes.
We
yes.
can do the right thing.
Exactly.
Judges can be forthright. Mm. Judges can act with dispatch
when
the circumstances are right.
Yeah.
And apparently, they all fell together in the right way in this particular case. And so the judge was able to say that the defense lacks legal protection and merit. Even though we're talking about a former governor, usually you don't hear it like that. You don't even get to the stage where the judge will talk about this in the next 5 years. Maybe it can come up in 6-10 years. But we want to thank everybody who's called in. It does look as if there is hope. It does
there
look
is.
Positive. The whole idea about it's not going to be business as usual, we're beginning to see inklings of that. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
Barrister Uche Ono.
Thank you very much.
Olanrewaju Suraj. Thank you very much. Chairman, Civil Society Network Against Corruption. That's our program for the day. You can see a repeat broadcast at midnight on TVC Entertainment. And then tomorrow morning between 6 and 7 a.m. on the two satellite channels we're available on, CONSAT and DSTV. You can see a repeat before the fresh edition comes on later on at 10:30. I'm Yori Folarin. Bye-bye for now.